and molybdenum. In Peru also, the llama is the principal beast of burden. Numerous herds are encountered, and here an Indian herdsman demonstrates his woollen sling, which he uses with astounding accuracy on the errant members of his flock. Nearby is the rare Vicunya, wild cousin of the llama. One must be careful when approaching either of them because of their vile habit of spitting when irritated. Soon the road reaches high barren ground at the edge of a valley, where it dips down to the shores of enormous but beautiful Lake Titicaca. Here on the shore is another group of native dancers and their brilliantly colored backdrop of ripening grain that are long to be remembered. Lake Titicaca is in reality a vast inland sea, its surface covering an area of 3,200 square miles. It's the highest navigable water in the world, in the heart of the Andes at an altitude of 12,500 feet above sea level, so large that ocean-sized steamers ply their way between its principal ports. This oversized blue jewel in its rugged mountain setting is an important link in the interchange of trade between Peru and Bolivia. After traveling over miles of high, level, barren plateau, a huge mountain bowl looms up, in the center of which lies La Paz, highest capital in the world, and heart of one of the most important tin-producing nations. La Paz, too, is a beautiful and modern city than one would expect hidden away in this mountain valley. Streets are wide, clean, and well-maintained, while its buildings rival those of many larger American cities. The population of Bolivia is more than half Indian, and the gay costumes of the natives strike a colorful note against the imposing colonial buildings and modern office structures. Crystal clear and deep blue glacial streams abound in this region and flow down from the mountain tops to supply the needed moisture for Bolivia's agriculture, most of which is still in the primitive stages. The branch of the Pan-American highway system extending through Bolivia continues on to Buenos Aires, Argentina. But from Peru, another of the world's nitrate, as compared to the 90% she produced before the First World War. In spite of this, however, the large-scale nitrate plants are very impressive. Leaving this barren land, the highway now swings down to the rocky shores of the Pacific, and vistas of rugged beauty are a welcome relief from the monotony of the desert scenery. Continuing southward, this fine paved road runs through the thriving port of Valparaiso to Santiago, some 80 miles inland. Although modern cities are commonplace in South America, agriculture has not kept pace, and for the most part is still carried on in a somewhat primitive manner. Progress is being made, however, and an ever-increasing amount of modern mechanized farm machinery is seen, like this diesel crawler tractor and plow, turning over more earth in an hour than 10 natives could turn over in a day of back-breaking toil. Mechanization of both industry and agriculture will bring a new and better way of life to all of our Latin American neighbors. Santiago lies nestled in a broad, fertile valley, rich in agriculture and commerce, a natural garden spot with the lofty Andes peaks in the background. The highway gradually descends into the valley, but a splendid view of this modern city is obtained from observation points along the route. Santiago is a city both old and new. Fourth largest in South America, it has the bustle of a thriving metropolis, and yet there are numerous parks and quiet places. Skyscrapers stand out in distinct contrast to old Spanish churches and buildings, and there are no slums. Both men and women are smartly dressed, and they walk with the brisk stride of a man. Yes, tourists from the United States would feel very much at home in this pleasant atmosphere. Large quantities of fruit are grown in Chile and are sold everywhere on the streets. Chileans are a cultured people interested in the arts, music, science, and literature. Newsstands on every corner carry every type of magazine found in the United States, and there are many fine bookstores. Santiago is the southwest terminus of the Pan-American Highway, and here the road turns sharply to the east and heads directly into the Andean foothills. Now the road thrusts itself up and over the Andes once more and sets its course for Buenos Aires in Argentina. This section of the road passes through some of the most breathtaking and spectacular mountain scenery in the world. On all sides, one is surrounded by towering Andean peaks, their crevices streaked with snow, and their summits jutting heavenward into a cold, crystal clear blue sky. For miles, the highway zigzags upward until at last, after an ascent of many thousands of feet, it reaches the summit of the Christ of the Andes Pass. Here, on the Argentine-Chilean border, stands this huge bronze figure of his hand uplifted, symbolic of the goodwill existing at nations. Soon the road descends on the eastern side of the Andes amid a panorama of mountain splendor and speeds across the famous Pampas, which stretches out endlessly to an ever-receding horizon. The scenery is unchanging except for an occasional ranch house, for this is in the heart of the cattle country. Home of Argentine beef, for which the country is famous. It has been estimated that more than 33 million head of livestock roam the Pampas, including dairy herds, sheep, horses, hogs, and mules. Colorfully dressed gauchos are counterparts of the American cowboy, with their boleadoros consisting of three weights attached to rawhide thongs, which wrap themselves around the legs of cattle when thrown. The road is blocked occasionally by herds of milling sheep, which represent not the least important part of Argentina's livestock program, making it the second largest exporter of wool in the world. Characteristic of the Pampas are the unforgettable sunsets, as the entire sky radiates the reddish reflection of the Argentine sun disappearing under the horizon. Approaching Buenos Aires, a modern two-lane concrete highway has been built on which traffic rolls at a rapid pace. The Argentine road program is a very progressive one, and many fine highways like this bear witness to that fact. The average American will be amazed on his first visit to Buenos Aires, capital of Argentina, and South America's largest city. He will find things superior in some respects to any of the large cities at home. Quiet, clean subways, vast underground parking areas, and service stations in the center of the city. Here the waters of the mighty Atlantic Ocean lap the sandy beaches of a charming, friendly, but completely modern metropolis. And it is with reluctance in one's heart that BA is left behind as the highway now swings north along toward its bustling harbor. Directly across the River Plata is Uruguay and the start on the last lap of the road toward Rio de Janeiro. One's first glimpse of Uruguay is the impressive skyline of Montevideo. One third of this small country's population lives here in its charming capital. In Uruguay, one finds democracy at work. For the secret ballot, industrial insurance, old age pensions, and the 8-hour day are guaranteed by the Constitution. Uruguay has an excellent highway system and traffic moves rapidly along, particularly northward toward her good neighbor, Brazil. Here the highway will eventually skirt the shoreline, then lead into the rolling red hills of southern Brazil. Moving ever northward, it leads through many small and medium-sized towns and villages. All are neat and clean, and their people are largely of the white race. Some of the larger cities, like Curitiba, the stately capital of Paraná, have impressive churches, modern buildings, and lovely parks. North of Curitiba, the road twists and turns through the hills. Few of the hills are paved at present, but rapid strides are now being made in this direction. Progressive government leaders realize the importance of a good system of roads, and all over Brazil, tractors, scrapers, and bulldozers are at work, moving huge loads of earth, pushing their way through mountains, building a network of roads that will bring a better way of life to the people. These giant Alice Chalmers tractors are working on the Pan-American Highway, moving tons of the tough earth of southern Brazil. It is equipment like this which is making the dreams of the planners of this great network of roads a reality. Soon the heart of Brazil's livestock industry is encountered, and it's frequently necessary to slow down, allowing a herd of cattle to cross the road. Horses, sheep, and hogs are also raised in this area. Agriculture is the principal industry of Brazil, and although coffee is the principal crop, cotton is becoming increasingly important, and many bales are being exported to the United States. Rio de Janeiro, the journey's end, is the next objective. There are no roads of any account north of Rio. The harbor here is probably as 365 mountain peaks surround the bay in which it lies. Famous among them is Sugarloaf Mountain, which can be ascended by cable car. Rio is a gay city, the Paris of South America. Beautiful beaches, luxurious hotels, the casinos and the climate create an atmosphere of delightful leisure. Since 3 out of every 4 cups of the world's coffee are produced in Brazil, it's a nation of coffee drinkers, and there is nothing more pleasant than the sidewalk cafes and their delectable demi-tasse. The clean, wide streets, the shaded boulevards, and rugged beauty of the surrounding mountains make it one of the garden spots of the world. Temperature, hot at midday, is tempered by a cooling ocean breeze. Flowers are renowned among the mountback, or Corcovado, and from its summit, llama unfolds. Far below lies the crater, beyond which is the sparkling bay. Arms extended in the spirit of peace and universal brotherhood. Yes, this is the end of the highway, but it's only the beginning of a glorious future for all of the American republics. A future in which all nations can live in peace and security. The words of South America's great liberator, Simón, for United America.